Hello friends, my name is Tripti Mishra and I am your instructor for today. I will be discussing cybersecurity techniques part 1 with all of you. This module has been designed with an aim to introduce the learner with the various cybersecurity techniques. After going through this module, the learner shall be able to first understand the need of cybersecurity, second, understand the objectives of information security, third, understand different cybersecurity techniques, specifically authentication, antivirus, and firewall. And last, application of these cybersecurity techniques to prevent cybercrime. Now, I have a question for all of you. Is information security and cybersecurity the same thing? Actually, these terms are often misused because they are nearly synonymous. Both information security and cybersecurity are defined as the practice of defending information from unauthorized access, use, and modification or disruption. The only difference between the two disciplines is in the form of the data. While cybersecurity refers only to electronic security, information security is a broader term that encompasses all data, both physical and digital. In other words, cybersecurity involves protecting only digital data, like securing pictures that we upload on internet. Whereas information security protects not only data in motion, but also data at rest, like pictures stored on your phone even when not connected to the internet. Thus, cybersecurity is just a subset of information security. Remember this. Need of cybersecurity. First of all, you should understand the meaning and need of security. When we talk about the protection of computer hardware and software from any accidental or malicious access, use, modification, destruction, it is termed as security. The advent of internet has made cybersecurity an important aspect in today's world. The biggest challenge today is to secure data from malicious programs and people with iniquitous intentions. Numerous techniques are used by organizations to secure data from intruders. For example, if you want your computer not to be used by anyone, then you will use a password to provide security to your system. Similarly, we are using different security techniques to secure the data available on internet. Now tell me, what are the pillars of information security? Information security rests on three main pillars: confidentiality, integrity, and availability. These three pillars form what is often referred to as the CIA triad. The three concepts embody the fundamental security objectives for both data and for information and computing surfaces. FIPS PUB199 provides a useful characterization of these three objectives in terms of requirements and the definition of a loss of security in each category. Confidentiality covers both data confidentiality and privacy. Integrity covers both data and system integrity. And last, availability ensures timely and reliable access to and use of information. Confidentiality, integrity, and availability are the three main objectives of information security. First is confidentiality. It means to control or restrict access of critical or sensitive information to an individual. Loss of confidentiality is the unauthorized disclosure of information. For example, if you are sending your picture to your friend, then it should be confidential between you and your friend. If any other person is doing eavesdropping during your and your friend's communication, then it breaks the confidentiality of the message. Second is integrity. It involves protection against improper information modification or destruction. A loss of integrity is the unauthorized modification or destruction of information. For example, suppose you are sending your account number to your friend to transfer money into your account. Now, if an attacker modifies the account number and places his account number in place of yours, then the integrity of the message breaks. If your friend receives the attacker's account number, he will send the money to the attacker's account, not yours. Also, if someone was sending online money transfer for, let's say, $1,000, but the information was altered or modified in such a way that the transfer value changed to $10,000, it could be very costly for him. So the integrity of the message should also be maintained for secure transmission. Third is availability. It is ensuring timely and reliable access to and use of information. A loss of availability is the disruption of access to or use of information. For example, if you're trying to access any website, an attacker already sent multiple requests to the server, then the server of the website will not be able to process your request. That means the data is not available to the authentic or authorized user. There is an unavailability of data. Also, service disruptions in a network due to hardware failures, software failures, or power outages and system upgrades could make the system or server unavailable. There is unavailability of data. Also, service disruptions in a network due to hardware failure, software failure, or power outages and system upgrades could make the system or server unavailable. So it should be kept in mind by providing security that the data should be available to the authorized user whenever required. Although the use of the CIA triad to define security objectives is well established, some in the security field feel that additional concepts are needed to present a complete picture. Four most commonly mentioned are authentication, authorization, accountability, and non-repudiation. Authentication. It is the process of verifying that the identified user is the real owner of his or her identity. For example, to access your Facebook account, you should enter valid ID and password. Your ID and password proves your authenticity. Another example can be, after swiping the ATM card, the user is supposed to enter his secret PIN. Once it is entered, the user is authenticated to perform the desired transaction. Second is authorization. It is the process of ensuring that an employee has enough access rights to a particular information so that he can perform intended actions. For example, once you enter valid credentials to your Facebook account, you are authorized to perform all that you have permission to do, like post pictures, post videos, post statuses, etc. Accountability. It focuses that for any actions taken by an entity can be traced uniquely to that entity. For example, after the user is authorized to access his account, through the credentials, he is accountable for any task that is carried out by him on his account. The last is non-repudiation. Non-repudiation is the assurance that someone cannot deny something. A legal document typically requires witnesses to signing so that the person who signs cannot deny having done so. For example, suppose you have sent a message to someone, but after a few days, you are denying that you have sent the message. In this case, the digital signature ensures non-repudiation. This will be discussed in later slides. You can understand all these objectives with one simple example. Suppose your mother kept a chocolate ice cream in the fridge for you, and your brother already has eaten his ice cream. So your mother asked you to keep your ice cream safe from your brother, otherwise he will eat yours as well. You have used lock in the fridge to keep your ice cream safe from your brother. In above scenario, your mother is the sender and you are the receiver of ice cream. The message that ice cream is kept inside the fridge is confidential between you and your mother. You are authentic user to access your ice cream. If your brother wants that ice cream, he should take permission from you or your mother to eat that. Suppose your brother got the keys of the fridge, So he's not only authentic, but even authorized to eat your ice cream now. Think that he eats all of your chocolate ice cream and keeps another flavor ice cream in its place. In this case, he is modifying or changing the content. That is, he is breaking the integrity of the content. But in all this case, who will be accountable? Of course, you, as you were supposed to keep the key of the fridge safely. Then suppose you kept the key of the fridge somewhere and forgot. So there is unavailability of data. That is, data is not available even to the authentic user. Now suppose your mother told you to keep your ice cream safe from your brother, but when your brother confronts his mother that did she restrict him from eating his sister's ice cream, and your mother denies saying so. But if you would have already recorded your mother's statement, this would ensure non-repudiation. In that case, your mother could not deny because her statement has already been recorded. I hope this clears all the objectives of information security. So now let us learn about various cybersecurity techniques: authentication, antivirus, and firewall. These are some methods by which we can prevent cyber crimes. We will discuss these methods one by one in detail. The first cybersecurity technique that we are going to discuss is authentication. What is authentication? Authentication is a process of identifying an individual and ensuring that the individual is the same who he or she claims to be. It is the process of ascertaining claimed user identity by verifying user provided evidence. For example, as you can see in the image, username is required to identify who are you, and the password is required to ensure that you are the authentic user. Once you enter valid credentials, you will be authenticated. Authentication in simple term is positive verification of identity, either man or machine. In most computer security concepts, user authentication is the fundamental building block and the primary line of defense. User authentication is the basis for most types of access control and for user accountability. An authentication process mainly comprises two steps: identification step and verification step. In identification step, we are first trying to identify the entity by presenting an identifier to the security system. An identifier should be assigned carefully because authenticated identities are the basis for other security services such as access control service. For example, you are uniquely identified in your class by your roll number. So, roll number is your identifier. Then, verification step involves presenting or generating authentication information that corroborates the binding between the entity and the identifier. Like when user enters his credentials, they are matched with the database to verify that he is the authentic user or not. What are the means of authentication? Traditionally, there are three means of authentication. First, something you know, like password or your PIN numbers. Second, something you have, like an iCard, RFID badge. And last, something you are, like biometrics. All of these methods, if properly implemented and used, can provide secure user authentication. Authentication categories. Authentication has been divided into three categories. First, what you know, which is also known as knowledge-based authentication. Second, what you have, which is also known as artifact-based authentication. And last, who you are, which is also known as biometric-based authentication. However, each category has its own problems, like an adversary may be able to guess or steal a password, or may be able to forge or steal a token, or a user may forget a password or lose a token. Further, there is a significant administrative overhead for managing password and token information on systems and securing such information on systems. With respect to biometric authenticators, there are a variety of problems, including dealing with user acceptance, cost, and convenience. Moving forward, we are now going to discuss the types of authentication. There are various techniques, or rather types, to authenticate a user. First, password-based authentication. Second, certificate-based authentication. Third, biometrics-based authentication. And last, e-token-based authentication. Let us first consider password-based authentication. In this method of authentication, the user who wants to communicate with the server has to provide its username and password to the server in order to prove his identity in the network. The ID and password of the user determine first whether the user is authorized to gain access to the system. In some systems, only those who already have an ID filed in the system are allowed to gain access. Second, the privileges accorded to the user. A few users may have, let's say, supervisory or super user status that enables them to read files and perform functions that are specially protected by the operating system. And some systems have guest or anonymous accounts, and users of these accounts have more limited privileges than others. Last is the discretionary access control. In DAC, each system object has an owner, and each initial object owner is the subject that causes its creation. Thus, an object's access policy is determined by its owner. DACs are discretionary because the subject, that is the owner, can transfer authenticated objects or information access to other users. In other words, the owner determines object access privileges. For example, by listing the IDs of the other users, a user may grant permission to them to read the files owned by that user. Let us now have a look at password-based authentication process. This figure shows how client and web server interact using password-based authentication mechanism. First, the user enters his name and password. Then the client sends name and password to the server across the network. Then web server uses password to authenticate user's identity, and web server only authorizes access for authenticated identity. So now we know password is used to authenticate users. So what are the types of passwords? The passwords can be of one of the types: plain text passwords, encrypted passwords, one-time passwords, or hashed passwords. End users type passwords, and those passwords remain visible on the screen after being typed. These are plain text passwords like ABC, XYZ. When you are typing them, they are visible on the screen. When end users type passwords and those passwords remain invisible on the screen after being typed, like you are typing ABC, but asterisk, asterisk, asterisk is visible on the screen. These are encrypted passwords. One-time passwords are the passwords that are valid for only one login session or transaction on a computer system or other digital device. You can receive an OTP on your phone or email to complete a transaction that can be used up to a limited time period only. Last are the hashed passwords. Hashing performs a one-way transformation on a password, turning the password into another string called the hash passwords. We will discuss about these in detail in later slides. Considering the fact that plain text passwords and encrypted passwords are clear to you, we are discussing one-time passwords and hashed passwords in detail. So let us first discuss about one-time passwords. One-time password is a password that is disposable and applicable for only one login session or transaction on computer system. It involves three approaches. First approach. In this, the user and the system agree upon a list of passwords. That is, if an OTP is going to give you an access to a computer system, the disposable password you hold obviously should match the password the computer has in its memory. For example, in internet banking, when you enter transaction password, at the same time, you receive an OTP in the form of SMS on your phone. So you are supposed to enter both to complete a transaction. If both matches, transaction is successful, otherwise not. Second approach. In the second approach, the user and the system agree to sequentially update the passwords. Let's say on the basis of time. Example, the OTP is generated with the help of some counter. Let's say starting from 001, then 002, then 003, and so on. The third approach, in this, the user and the system create a sequentially updated password using a hash function. OTPs are generated using hash function to enhance security. For example, OTPs will be generated according to the system clock. We will discuss about hash function in the coming slide. What is a hash function? A hash function is any well-defined procedure or mathematical function for turning some kind of data into a relatively small integer. It is a one-way function. That is, after converting any password into random string or fixed length, we cannot get the password again with the help of that random string. For example, let's say the password is 123@54. It is converted to a hash value like anything SDJFKDS #451 using hash function. The values returned by a hash function are called hash values, hash codes, hash sums, or simply hashes. So other than one-time passwords, we have hashed passwords. In authentication, hashing is used to create a set of numbers that represent a drive or set of files called hashed passwords. This is similar to fingerprinting someone. With hashing, a fingerprint is created from the evidence. No details about the evidence can be determined from the hash value, but if the evidence is altered in any way, the hash value will also change. Cyber forensic experts, CyberCell, use hash values to maintain the integrity of evidence collected. HashCalci, Paladin tools are used by them for this purpose. The hashing is done on the data itself and not on the names of the files. That is, if we are using hashing algorithm on any file, then the content of the file is converted into hash value. If we are changing any value, that is even a single dot, the hash value will change. We have different hashing algorithms like MD5, SHA1, SHA2, etc. With the help of these algorithms, we can calculate the hash value of any file or text. As you can see in the given figure, we have different hashing algorithms that are used to convert the text into random string of fixed length. Like you can see, we have MD5, SHA1, SHA256. We will discuss some hashing algorithms in further slides. In the given figure, the text is hello all, and using MD5 algorithm, it is converted into some hash value that you can see inside the box of string hash. Now you can see that I have appended only dot after hello all. It changes the entire hash value. In this way, we can ensure the integrity of the document. For example, suppose you need some money and you are asking to your friend for help. Your friend says that, okay, send me your account number. I'll send you money. Now you are sending your account number to your friend, and in between, the attacker modifies it and writes his account number in place of yours. Then your friend cannot identify that the account number has been changed, and by thinking that that account number is yours, he'll send the money. In these cases, we are using hashing to ensure the integrity of the message. In this figure, you can see that the hash value of hello all is different for MD5 and SHA1 because each algorithm produces different output. Due to the flaws in the existing algorithm, a new algorithm came into existence. In MD5, we have collision problem that I'll discuss in further slide. MD5 stands for Message Digest 5. The MD5 Message Digest algorithm is a widely used cryptographic hash function producing a 128-bit or 16-byte hash value, typically expressed in text format as a 32-digit hexadecimal number. It produces a fixed length output of any text or file. It is used in various cryptographic applications to ensure the integrity of the document. MD5 was designed by Ronald Rivest in 1991 to replace an earlier hash function, MD4. MD5 has been broken using collision attack. What is collision attack in MD5? Collision means finding two different input strings of a hash function that produce the same hash value. Suppose we compute the hash of some string called innocent, which computes to 2345617 98. Now an attacker would try to find another input string generating the same hash value through some method like brute force attack. Let's say he finds another string dangerous, computes the hash which gives the same hash value 2345617 98. This is collision attack. In simple words, there are several ways a hash collision could be exploited. If the attacker was offering a file download and showed the hash to prove the file's integrity, he could switch out the file download for a different file that had the same hash, and the person downloading it would be unable to know the difference. The file would appear valid as it has the same hash as the supposed real file. SHA-1 stands for Secure Hash Algorithm 1. After collision attack in MD5, SHA-1 was discovered. It generates 160-bit hash value. This was designed by the National Security Agency, NSA, to be part of the digital signature algorithm. Some cryptographic weaknesses were discovered in SHA-1. Also, that's why standard was no longer approved for most cryptographic users after 2010. SHA-2, Secure Hash Algorithm 2. A family of two similar hash functions with different block sizes known as SHA-256 and SHA-512. They differ in the word size. SHA-256 uses 32-bit words while SHA-512 uses 64-bit words. There are also truncated versions of each standard known as SHA-224, SHA-384, SHA-512/224. These were also designed by the NSA. What are the uses of hashing? We can use hashing for verification, that is, it can be used to show that data object has not changed. It specifically helps the forensic experts while producing evidence in court of law. Hashing is also a way to identify and eliminate from analysis all files that contain no potential evidence, for example, software files. It is also used to identify the needle in the haystack. If known hash value may help investigator to find the one file out of thousands of other files. Hash value match for file exclusion. Examples such as operating system files. This is also known as negative hashing. Hash value match for file flagging. It is a list of hash values for known and sought out files that can be compiled and used to search for and identify files of interest to the investigator. Now, can you tell me how can passwords be protected? MD5 hashing algorithm is a one-way cryptographic function that accepts a message of any length as input and returns as output a fixed length digest value to be used for authenticating the original message, right? If we use salt along with MD5, we can protect our passwords. But what is salt? The salt serves three purposes. First, it prevents duplicate passwords from being visible in the password file. Even if two users choose the same password, those passwords will be assigned different salt values. Hence, the hashed passwords of the two users will be different. It greatly increases the difficulty of offline dictionary attacks. For a salt of length B bits, the number of possible passwords is increased by a factor of 2B, increasing the difficulty of guessing a password in a dictionary attack. It becomes nearly impossible to find out whether a person with passwords on two or more systems has used the same password on all of them. So the best way will be that a user's password is first encrypted using MD5 algorithm, then salted, and then stored. The stored password can thus never be decrypted. It will be difficult for an attacker to revert the stored password to the plain text password. The following procedure is employed, as you can see in the figure. To load a new password into the system, the user selects or is assigned a new password. This password is combined with a fixed length salt value. The password and salt serve as inputs to a hashing algorithm to produce a fixed length hash code. The hash algorithm is designed to be slow to execute thwart attacks. The hashed passwords is then stored together with plain text copy of the salt in the password file for the corresponding user ID. Benefits of password-based authentication. Passwords have been successfully providing security for systems for a long time. These are easy to manage. These are effective means to provide security when properly managed in a controlled environment. Drawbacks of password-based authentication. We can guess the password. We can get the password by shoulder surfing. If we are giving passwords to someone, he or she can misuse the password. Electronic monitoring can be done. That is, if the password is not transmitted in encrypted form, then it can be identified using network monitoring tools like Wireshark, etc. And last is accessing the password files. That is, we can access the password file using some attacks like SQL injection attack. Another user authentication type is certificate-based authentication. It is the use of a digital certificate to identify a user, machine, or device before granting access to a resource, network, application, etc. Certificate-based authentication is stronger as compared to password-based authentication. Digital certificates can then be reused for user authentication. Certificates are stored locally on the machine or device. Unlike some authentication methods like biometrics or OTP tokens, there is no additional hardware needed. This not only saves on costs, but can also alleviate management pains around distributing, replacing, and revoking tokens. What is a digital certificate? A digital certificate is an electronic password or document that allows a person, organization to exchange data securely over the internet using public key infrastructure. Digital certificate is also known as public key certificate or identity certificate. An individual wishing to send an encrypted message applies for a digital certificate from a certificate authority. You can see an example of digital certificate and see what all information it contains, like the purpose, issued to, issued by, and the validity of this digital certificate. Use of digital certificate. The most common use of digital certificate is to verify that a user sending a message is who he or she claims to be, and to provide the receiver with the means to encode a reply. An individual wishing to send an encrypted message applies for a digital certificate from a certificate authority. Digital certificates are used in public key cryptography functions. They are most commonly used for initializing secure SSL connections between web browsers and web servers. Let us have a look at public key infrastructure, PKI, which is intended to offer a means of providing security to messages and transactions on a grand scale. PKI is a digital certificate management system for generation, distribution, storage, and verification of certificates. One or more directories where the certificates with their public keys are stored. It involves certificate authority, registration authority, and validation authority. A certificate authority, CA, issues and verifies digital certificates. A registration authority, RA, acts as the verifier of the certificate authority. First, a user applies for a certificate with his public key at a registration authority. The latter confirms the user identity to the certification authority, which in turn issues the certificate. The user can then digitally sign a contract using his new certificate. His identity is then checked by the contracting party with the validation authority VA, which again receives information about issued certificates by the certification authority. Use of certificate-based authentication. One differentiator of certificate-based authentication is that, unlike some solutions that only work for users, such as biometrics and one-time passwords, The same solution can be used for all endpoints, user, machines, devices, and even the growing Internet of Things, IoT. It is used in combination of password-based authentication to provide better security. So overall, it not only provides user authentication, but machine and device authentication as well. Third type of user authentication is e-token-based authentication. Objects that a user possesses for the purpose of user authentication are called tokens. An authentication token is a small device that generates a new random value every time it is used. This random value becomes the basis for authentication. It is an alternative to a password and can be implemented on a USB key or a smart card. Examples of e-token based authentication include memory cards and smart cards. Memory cards. Memory cards can store but not process data. Everyone uses them in real time. The most common such card is the bank card with a magnetic stripe on the back. A magnetic stripe can store only a simple security code which can be read by an inexpensive card reader. There are also memory cards that include an internal electronic memory. The memory card, when combined with a PIN or password, provides significantly greater security than a password alone. An adversary must gain physical possession of the card plus must gain knowledge of the PIN. Along with advantages, there are a few drawbacks of memory cards as well. First, it requires a special card reader. This increases the cost of using the token and creates the requirement to maintain the security of the reader's hardware and software. Second, token loss. A lost token temporarily prevents its owner from gaining system access, giving an administrative cost in replacing the lost token. Also, if the token is found, stolen, or forged, then an adversary now need only determine the PIN to gain unauthorized access. Third is user dissatisfaction. Although users may have no difficulty in accepting the use of a memory card for ATM access, its use for computer access may be deemed inconvenient. Another e-token based authentication is smart card. A smart card contains within it an entire microprocessor, including processor, memory, and input-output ports. Nowadays, banking organizations have made it compulsory to use smart cards containing a chip rather than cards having black magnetic stripe due to the drawbacks associated with it. Some versions incorporate a special co-processing circuit for cryptographic operation to speed the task of encoding and decoding messages or generating digital signatures to validate the information transferred. A wide variety of devices qualify as smart tokens. These can be categorized along three dimensions that are not mutually exclusive. First, physical characteristics. Smart tokens include an embedded microprocessor. A smart token that looks like a bank card is called a smart card. Other smart tokens can look like calculators, keys, or other small portable objects. Second, interface. Manual interfaces include a keypad and display for human token interaction. Smart tokens with an electronic interface communicate with a compatible reader-writer. Third, authentication protocol. To provide a means for user authentication. It is divided into three types: static, dynamic password generator, and challenge response. In static, the user authenticates himself or herself to the token, and then the token authenticates the user to the computer. The latter half of this protocol is similar to the operation of a memory token. Dynamic password generator. The token generates a unique password periodically, for example, every minute. This password is then entered into the computer system for authentication either manually by the user or electronically by the token. The token in the computer system must be initialized and kept synchronized so that the computer knows the password that is current for this token. Last is challenge response. The computer system generates a challenge, such as random string of numbers. The smart token generates a response based on that challenge. Benefits of smart token. One-time passwords are used with smart token to enhance the level of security. It reduces the risk of forgery, and it is used for multiple applications like for identification, cash cards, etc. Examples of smart token include metro cards, driving licenses, etc. Drawbacks of smart token. It needs reader-writer to access the information stored in cards. It also requires human intervention to access that, like we have to enter PIN to collect cash with debit cards. If cryptography is used to manage the information, then it will require substantial administration to manage cryptographic keys. The last type of user authentication technique is biometric authentication. Biometric authentication attempts to authenticate an individual based on his or her unique physical characteristics. Physical characteristics can be static or dynamic. Static characteristics include fingerprints, hand geometry, facial characteristics, and retinal and iris patterns, and dynamic characteristics such as voice, iris, and signature. In essence, biometric is based on pattern recognition. Compared to passwords and tokens, biometric authentication is both technically complex and expensive. While it is used in a number of specific applications, biometrics has yet to mature as a standard tool for user authentication to computer systems. Best example of biometric authentication is Aadhaar card that uses fingerprint and iris scan characteristics to uniquely identify a person in India. It uses combination of various algorithms to do so. Biometrics can be divided into two categories, physiological and behavior. Physiological includes fingerprint, iris, retina, face, hands, voice, DNA, etc. Whereas behavioral includes signature, keystroke, etc. Examples are fingerprint in mobile device to authenticate you. This is physiological, right? What if a user is authenticated to access a system in future with the help of his typing speed? So a lot can be done in this area to enhance the security of a system. Let us see how the biometric authentication process takes place. The user database contains a sample of users' biometric characteristics. This is the initial phase. During authentication process, the user is required to provide a new sample of the user's biometric at runtime. This sample is sent for encryption. This current sample is decrypted and compared. If the sample matches, user is considered as a valid one, that is authentic, otherwise unauthentic. This was simple, right? Applications of biometric authentication. Several applications of biometrics are already in use. In commercial environments, these include access to facilities, access to information systems, transaction at point of sales, and employee timekeeping. In the law enforcement system, they include investigations using fingerprints or DNA and forensic analysis. Border control and immigration control also use some biometric techniques. Let's have a look at it. The figure describes a typical simplified workflow of an automatic border control system, eGate, using an electronic passport of a citizen. E-passport is first scanned using scanner contactless reader. Border control system then checks for security features in e-passport. Then the chip is read for data authentication. At last, biometric verification is performed by face recognition system. If everything matches, the document is valid and the citizen is allowed. Benefits of biometric authentication. They are highly secure. We cannot forge the physical characteristics of any individual, so reduces the chance of forgery. Drawbacks of biometric authentication. They are complex to manage. To process the information or data, they require costly, expensive tools. Different challenges occur during the processing of information. For example, let's say front face is stored in database and we get the face that is non-frontal. Then the system will not be able to detect the face. Elimination problem will occur. Or let's say you used to authenticate your mobile with your fingerprint, which is a little bit damaged due to cuts and marks on it. Your phone might not be able to identify you. Authentication is not limited to user level. Authentication is required in distribution systems as well. Single sign-on, SSO, is a user session authentication process that permits a user to enter one name and password in order to access multiple applications. The process authenticates the user for all the applications they have been given rights to and eliminates further prompts when they switch applications during a particular session. The best example of SSO is Gmail. When you log on to your Gmail account, you can access YouTube, Google Photos, Google Plus, Calendar, Photos, Map, etc. You don't need to log into each application separately. You are authenticated to access all the applications by signing into one account. But it has a disadvantage too. If an attacker gets hold of your password, he can access data stored on all the applications. Here, figure shows that a person uses firewall and SSO system to access email, HR information, corporate intranet, and client extranet, and whatnot. Challenges in authentication. There are various challenges while authenticating a person. First, collection of authenticating data, that is, storing ID and password of all users securely. Second, transmitting the data securely. That is, if we want to access any resource, first we have to enter user ID and password for authenticating oneself. Then those credentials are transmitted through a channel or network to the server. And after the verification done by the server, one is authorized to access that resource. In this condition, one's credentials should pass through a secure channel. Otherwise, it will be misused. The third challenge in authentication is to ensure that whether the person who was originally authenticated is still the person using the computer system or not. Like in bank website, there is a session timeout. That is, if the system is idle for some time, then you will have to again enter your credentials to authenticate yourself. Now we are going to discuss another cybersecurity technique, that is antivirus. Before starting the discussion on antivirus, we should know the meaning of virus and other types of malwares. I'm assuming you all have already gone through virus, worms, Trojan horse, etc. in module 1 under section malware and its types. To revise the concept, what is a virus? Virus stands for Vital Information Resources under SIS. Computer viruses are small software programs that are designed to spread from one computer to another to interfere with computer operations. Virus can spread through attachments of funny images, greeting cards, audio, or video files. A virus might corrupt or delete data on your computer. Keep one thing in mind. Virus require human intervention. Types of virus. There are three different types of viruses: boot sector virus, program virus, and macro virus. Boot sector viruses were most predominant viruses until mid-90s. They infect boot sectors on diskettes and hard disks. On diskettes, the boot sector normally contains code to load the operating system files. Then there are program viruses, the second type of computer viruses. They infect executable programs, usually .com and .exe files, but they sometimes also infect overlay files, device drivers, or even object files. Third is macro virus. Viruses which do not infect normal programs, but instead spread as macros in various types of files. A macro virus is a computer virus written in the same macro language used for software programs like Microsoft Excel, Microsoft Outlook, or word processors like MS Word. When a macro virus infects a software application, it causes a sequence of actions, generally to harm, to begin automatically when the application is open. This type of virus can easily spread through email when users unknowingly exchange infected documents. There are different types of malwares other than viruses, like Trojan horse, worms, scareware, adware, spyware. As we have already learned all these terms in module 1, let's just have a quick recap of their definitions. Trojan horse. It is a malicious code that is installed in the host machine by pretending to be useful software. The user clicks on the link or download the file which pretends to be useful file or software from legitimate source. It not only damages the host computer by manipulating the data, but also creates a backdoor in the host computer so that it could be controlled by a remote computer. Worms. They are a class of virus which can replicate themselves. They are different from the virus by the fact that they do not require human intervention to travel over the network and spread from one infected machine to the whole network. These are more dangerous than the viruses. Scareware. Internet has changed how we talk, shop, play, and a lot more. It has even changed the way how the criminal target the people for ransom. While surfing the internet, suddenly a pop-up alert appears in the screen which warns the presence of dangerous virus, spywares, etc. in the user's computer. As a remedial measure, the message suggests to download the full paid version of the software. As the user proceeds to download, a malicious code known as scareware is downloaded in the host computer. It holds the host computer hostage until some ransom is paid. The malicious code can neither be uninstalled nor can the computer be used till the ransom is paid. Adware. It is a special type of malware which is used for forced advertising. They either redirect the page to some advertising page or pop up an additional page which promotes some product or event. Spyware. It is a special type which is installed in the target computer with or without the user permission and is designed to steal sensitive information from the target machine. Mostly it gathers the browsing habits of the user and sends it to the remote server without the knowledge of the owner of the computer. Keylogger is the best example of spyware. It can be used by criminals to steal information and used by law enforcement to grab a criminal. Now the question arises that from where these viruses come from. Basically, a virus is a malicious code that is designed by an individual with the motive to create problems and troubles for others. Some people create viruses and malware because they enjoy causing trouble and making others suffer. Biological viruses are created by their own, but computer viruses are deliberately created by programmers or people. How do viruses spread? Viruses are most easily spread by attachments in email messages or instant messaging messages. This is why it is essential that you never open email attachments unless you know who it is from or from whom you are expecting it. A virus is an infected system which may send a web address link as a message to other contacting system. Thinking the link is from a friend, the recipient may sometimes follow the link and virus spreads in that system also. Viruses also spread through downloads from the internet. They can be hidden in illicit software or other files or programs you might download. A virus can copy itself and infect a computer without permission or knowledge of the user. A virus cannot be spread without human action. That is, if you have received a file that is infected, but you have not opened it, then in that case, virus will not spread in your system. Viruses can also be spread through removable media like floppy disk, pen drive, hard drive, CD, USB drive, etc. Can you all jot down few damages done by viruses? Let me help you with a few. Sometimes display unwanted messages that irritates the user. It can clog computer memory and sometimes system crashes. It can delete the files, format hard drives that lead to the loss of data. For example, let's say an Indian hacks a Pakistani website and displays Jai Hind on it. The damage caused by these viruses varies from minor delays in computer function to complete destruction of your hard drive. For companies, the price is far higher. A downed website can cost a company millions of dollars a day. Viruses are written for vandalism, which is an action involving deliberate destruction of or damage to public or private property, to attack the products of specific companies, to distribute political messages, and financial gain from identity theft. What would you do if you find that your system has a virus? If you find that your system has a virus, clean your computer with antivirus software. We will discuss antivirus in detail in further slides. If your computer is still not working properly, consider hiring a trusted expert who can recover your data. Data can be successfully extracted from corrupted hard drive, but it is a complex process that will require another computer, special software, and a technician with experience in data recovery. Remember, nothing gives you 100% security. But by using antivirus software and firewall, we can improve our computer security up to some extent. You can continue to improve your computer security and decrease the possibility of infection by using a firewall, keeping your system up to date, maintaining a current antivirus software subscription, and follow some practices. How to prevent system from computer viruses? First, do not open emails and email attachments if received from unknown and untrusted sources. Ensure that you examine and scan email and other attachments before they run, as they might contain viruses. For example, download a mobile application from a trusted source only. Second, avoid downloading files, games, screensavers, etc. from unsecure websites. Be sure that the source is a legitimate and reputable one. For example, do not download songs from insecure websites that redirect you to some adverts, etc. Third, use different antivirus softwares and keep your antivirus updated. Note, purchase a licensed version of an antivirus having a key. Fourth, configure your antivirus software to boot automatically on startup and run at all times. If you are not using updated antivirus, variations of viruses and new ones can be skipped to check. In continuation to the previous slide, take care using USB flashcards, CDs, floppy disk, and external hard drives. The more flashcards, CDs, floppies, hard drives have been used on, the better the chance of virus infecting them, so clean them before use. If your computer is on network, make sure you have security steps in place to prevent unauthorized users putting files on your computer. Antivirus. Antivirus is a computer program that is used to identify and eliminate computer viruses, like penicillin used as an antibiotic for human body. Similarly, antivirus acts as a guard for your system. They scan all files and applications and clean up the unwanted viruses that are harmful to your system. Antivirus software is considered to be an aid that detects, fixes, and even prevents viruses and worms from spreading to your computer as well as connecting computers. After installing an antivirus, you should scan your system periodically. Always keep your antivirus running so that it can provide constant protection. We can scan our files or system in two ways: automatic scan or manual scan. In automatic scan, it automatically scans the files or directories at specific intervals of time. The other way to scan the files or directories or system is manual scan. In this, saving and scanning email attachments or web downloads rather than selecting the option to open them directly from the source is done. Scanning floppy disks, CDs, DVDs, hard drives for viruses before opening any of the files is also done through this scan. Working of antivirus. Antivirus applications maintain a database of known viruses and compare scanned files that match the characteristics of known viruses. If a scanned file matches those characteristics of known viruses, it is quarantined, which means moved to a new, presumably safe location on a disk and renamed so you can find it if you ever need it, so that it cannot affect other files on your system. VirusTotal is a tool that maintains database of viruses from various antiviruses. You can upload and analyze any file to check for virus in it. Antivirus scans files or your computer's memory for certain patterns that may indicate an infection. The patterns it looks for are based on the signatures or fingerprints of known viruses. Once the virus is detected in the wild, the antivirus companies then release the new patterns for your antivirus software to use. These updates come out daily by some vendors. Virus authors are continually releasing new and updated viruses. So it is important that you have the latest definitions installed on your computer. Signature detection is just one way of identifying viruses and is only effective if the virus database is up to date and contains the signature of virus. Antivirus programs also attempt to identify suspicious behavior that include an application attempting to write to an executable file, altering needed system files, making suspicious registry entries, or adding to the list of items that execute automatically upon system startup. Once the file is quarantined, the application can attempt to repair it, delete it, or prompt you for a decision on what do you want to do about the file that is infected. In this figure, you can see that whenever an antivirus detects a malicious code, it asks to perform the action, whether to keep it or remove that file. This is the block diagram that represents the working of an antivirus software. The information starts from the source system and must reach to the destination system. Source system could be anything like floppy disk, hard drive, etc. And destination system could be hard drive of a computer or an ISP, Internet Service Provider, which stores the message, sends them when a client requires. The information interpretation system varies depending upon a special mechanism or whether it is implemented in operating system. This interpretation mechanism is specific for each OS or depending on component in which antivirus program is implemented. For example, in Windows 8, a virtual driver is used which monitors the activity of disks. Therefore, every time the information is accessed through floppy disk or hard drive, then antivirus program will intercept the read and write call to the disk and then scan the information so that anybody can read it safely. All these operations work through the kernel in Windows XP/2000. All antivirus softwares have different interpretation mechanism. It is not only made for the OS, but also other applications. Sometimes interpretation mechanism is not available by the antivirus program or by any application. So it uses other resources. Resources that secretly take information and pass it to the antivirus, and then it scans the information and disinfects the file. Once the information has been scanned using any method, then two operations are performed. First, the clean information is sent to the interpretation phase so that it can continue towards the destination system. Second, alert message is sent to the user interface. User interface can vary. For example, in an antivirus of workstations, the message can be displayed on the screen directly, and an antivirus for server, the alert message could be sent to the mailbox. A lot of antivirus softwares are available in the market. Some of them are Bitdefender, Kaspersky, Panda, McAfee, QuickHeal, Avira, Avast, Norton, and a lot more. You can see the logos of various antiviruses available in the market. The last cybersecurity technique that I am going to discuss is firewall. You might have heard this term when I was discussing about viruses and antiviruses. A firewall is a system designed to prevent unauthorized access to or from a private network. Firewalls can be implemented in both hardware and software, or a combination of both. A firewall is a security policy enforcement point that regulates access between computer networks. Filters are inherently insecure services. Firewalls control TCP protocols, HTTP, SMTP, FTP, Telnet, etc. It is only one of many different security tools to control and regulate network traffic. What do firewalls protect? Firewalls protect not only data, but also resources and reputation. Data covers proprietary corporate information, financial information, and sensitive employee or customer data. Resources covers computing resources and time resources. And reputation covers loss of confidence in an organization or intruders uses an organization's network to attack other sites. There are various applications of firewall. Firewalls are used to defend resources, to validate access, to manage and control the network traffic, to record and report on events, and act as an intermediary between internal and external network. Now, firewalls protect an individual or organization from internal users? Why? Okay, tell me, if any student just for fun creates a virus and install on all the systems in the computer labs, what would happen? Or if an employee who is unhappy with his organization just before leaving the organization writes an e-bomb that would activate on a particular date after he leaves the organization, what would happen? Just think of it. Then, firewalls also protect the organization from the hackers. Corporate espionage, which is a practice of spying and monitoring the activities of employee in an organization. It also protects from terrorist activities and common thieves. Basic components of firewall. Firewall comprises the following: policy, advanced authentication, packet inspection, and application gateways. Just purchasing a good firewall is not sufficient. One must configure it properly, keeping the security objective in their minds. Operation of firewall. There are two access denial methodologies used by firewall. A firewall may allow all traffic through unless it meets certain criteria, or it may deny all traffic unless it meets a certain criteria, as you can see in the figure. The type of criteria used to determine whether the traffic should be allowed to varies from one type of firewall to another. Firewalls may be concerned with the type of traffic or with source or destination address and ports. They may also use complex rule bases that analyze the application data to determine if the traffic should be allowed through or not. How a firewall determines what traffic to let through depends on which network layer it operates at. Problems that firewalls cannot fix. There are few things that even the firewall cannot fix, like many email hacks, vulnerabilities in application protocols you allow. For example, incoming HTTP requests to an IIS server. Modems. Don't allow users on the internal network to use a modem in their machine to connect to an external ISP to connect to the internet. This exposes everything that user is connected to the external network. Many users don't like the restrictions that firewall places on them and will try to subvert those restrictions. I hope you might have understood the need of cybersecurity and information security. Also, I believe that you might have understood the cybersecurity techniques that I covered, namely authentication, antivirus, and firewall, and will be able to use them in real life to prevent cybercrimes. All these cybersecurity techniques are important to secure system and thereby data, not only in digital but physical form as well. Use effective and efficient authentication mechanism to secure your computer system from unauthorized access. Use licensed antiviruses to secure your computer system from malwares. And use system firewall to protect the system from insider as well as outsider threats. Thank you, and keep yourselves updated with upcoming threats and vulnerabilities in the market. Follow GB Hackers or The Hackers News for this purpose.